Well, good morning, everyone. Oops, let's try to turn this thing on. There we go. That sounds a little bit better. Well, welcome back to Bethel Baptist this morning. Glad to see Christine Curtis back with us. And I know that over the coming weeks, we're going to have additional people who are going to be coming back to join us as well, who've been absent. But I know a number of people are joining us online. And we rejoice that we can have the technology that allows us to reach people, even if they can't be here with us. Are there any announcements anyone has to share with us this morning? Okay, well, let's go ahead and we'll open our time in prayer, ask the Lord's blessing on our time, and then we'll get into our time of musical worship together. So let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the absolutely gorgeous day that you have given us and the beauty that is around us that is a reminder of your sovereignty, your creativeness, your care, and your love. Father, this morning I pray that we would worship you well, that you would help us to engage you in the scriptures and to be open to the moving of your Holy Spirit in us in whatever way that you want to move. I pray that you would be glorified and that we would receive well what you have to give us, but we would also give well when you call us to. In Jesus' name, amen. Well,
three beautiful Sunday mornings here in a row to come and worship our Lord. Another, like I said, another beautiful morning out there. Nice and cool. Have the windows open. Let the cool air come in. Let's stand up, and we're going to give our praise and our worship to the Lord this morning. You are worthy of our praise, Lord. this morning.
I raise
Well, this is our time of being able to pray together as a church family this morning. And there have been a few prayer requests that have been passed along to me. But before I get to those, are there any prayer requests that you guys have to share? There's a couple of others that have been mentioned too. Shirley's brother-in-law, Ed, is actually improving a little bit. He had fallen off a ladder, hit his head. But he is now trying to actually talk, and he is able to eat soft food. So all of which we didn't even think he'd ever make it this far. Her parents, Shirley's parents, are holding steady in their health. And also Mackenzie, she's responding well to the treatment so far, right? And she's actually able to eat and tolerate the food a little bit better.
A little bit.
So that's good, but continue to pray for her. Also, Mary Toll was able to get into the pain doctor, and she is going to be getting an injection in her back to hopefully help with that, with the pain she's been experiencing. That's coming up on the 22nd. So we'll be praying for her. And Doris shared with me this morning, too. She's going in for eye surgery this Thursday to repair some scratches on the cornea, right? So be praying for her. Are there any others that we have to pray for? Okay. Well, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Father God, I rejoice in the work that you are doing. Thank you so much for our church family and that we were able to uphold each other. We pray for Ed, and we just rejoice. For one, he survived, and now he's actually recovering, neither of which we were expecting to happen. And thank you so much that he is actually trying to communicate. And I pray that this forward movement would keep going to where he is able to regain so much of what he has lost. Thanks to Mackenzie is responding to the treatment, and I pray that this tolerance for food would grow so that she's able to tolerate more and more, get the nutrition that she needs. I also pray for her, too, as looking at going back to school and just all the struggles that come with the limitations that she is under in the midst of trying to be active and involved. Lord, I pray that you'd help her emotionally with that as well. Thanks to Shirley's parents are doing well, that Carter is healing, that you have brought Erica and her family back for a visit when it's been so long since they have been able to visit. Do pray, too, for Alice's parents and for their sustaining of their health. Thanks that Keith is out of the hospital, and I pray that you would help them to guard well his limitations, that he would not get overheated, have any more of the heart and breathing problems. But thank you that he's able to be back home. Pray for Doris as she heads in for surgery, that you would bring healing to her eye and her vision. Thanks that the first eye that she had done was successful, and I pray that the second one would be as well. And we also thank you, too, that Carter is recovering well from his injury, and I pray that he would, accept the limitations he's under, but still be able to be very active in the midst of this time, and you bring a full healing to his arm. I also pray for Amanda, as she is not doing well with her health. That's why she's not here this morning. Just been dealing with a lot of pain lately, and limitations just with her body being not very cooperative. Lord, I pray that you would bring her healing, not just from pain, but from this MS overall. Father, we rejoice in the world that you have given us, the country that we live in where we have freedoms. And we do pray for our country, as there is still much turmoil, that you would bring us settledness and peace. But we know that's only going to happen when you reign and we submit to your reign and your rule in our lives. And I pray that that would extend, that the influence of your church, that we would be strong and vibrant to bring about your light in our community, not just for Bethel right here in Bethel Village and in Columbus, but Lord, your church overall, unified and doing the work that you have called us to do. And Father, this morning, as we look specifically at the story of Gideon, Lord, I pray that you would challenge us to be able to see the world around us through your eyes, to hear your call, and respond to your call to action. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm glad that I am able to stand before you upright this morning. I had a little bit of exertion yesterday. I'm going to see if I can actually, Isaiah, can you come up and grab what's behind the pulpit here and bring it over to me? I'm kind of tethered to the camera right now because of my microphone. Come up here, and I want you to grab that thing that's behind the pulpit and bring it over to me. Yesterday, we undertook a project. I took a little video for you of what we were doing. And so, thanks. Okay, I got very familiar with this tool right here, all right, the sledgehammer. And so I borrowed this from Danny. And Danny, by the way, your wheelbarrow and sledgehammer are in the back of my van right now. So Jerry, you can go ahead and throw up that video there to show us. We have a brick wall around our patio. And we wanted to open things up a little bit and make it, oh, we can bring down the audio on that, Daryl. We don't need to hear that necessarily. But anyways, yeah, so we were knocking down this brick wall around our patio, put out the plea on Facebook, had 7 friends show up. Some of them whom I hardly know, and they brought their sledgehammers and their muscles, and we just had a grand old time knocking down this thing. It only took us two and a half hours, and we were done with the project. So it was wonderful. But I got to tell you, it is a messy process, and it is a noisy process, a little bit of a dangerous process. I went out to Lowe's and got, you know, Menards and got extra safety glasses and gloves, so everybody there was hopefully equipped and safe in the midst of this. But I actually even borrowed a power tool from somebody, but ended up not needing it because we had enough people with muscles and these big hammers to go up there and knock this down. But it's not something that you do necessarily in secret. It's not something that's an easy process to do. And what we're going to look at this morning in the story of Gideon is when God called him to, metaphorically, take up the sledgehammer, because I got some demolition work that I need for you to do. So if you turn to Judges chapter 6, this is where we're going to be now. I'm going to cover one verse that we covered last week in the story of Gideon, and that's going to get us a running start into where we're going to be today. Now, the one verse from last week ends the story of his encounter with God, really with the angel of the Lord is what the way it's written. And the angel of the Lord has a message to him and says, I'm calling you to go deliver Israel from the Midianites. See, Israel had been in sin, and so God had withdrawn his hand of protection from Israel, and the Midianites, these foreigners, had come in along with some other peoples and were just decimating the land. And they needed a leader to rise up and to drive them out, and God said, I'm choosing you, Gideon, to go do this. And Gideon was very fearful. He's like, me, you know, I'm not qualified for this, but God called him. And if God calls you, then he will qualify you. He will give you the ability to go do this. Now, I want to start now in Judges. Let me turn, I'm in the wrong book again. Joshua, there we go. Judges chapter 6, and we're going to start in verse 24. At the end of this encounter, it says, Gideon built an altar there to the Lord, Yahweh, and named it Yahweh is Peace. To this day, it is still an Ophrah of the Abiezrites. Now, let's go on into verse 25. Now on that same night, Yahweh said to him, take your father's bull and a second bull, 7 years old, and pull down the altar of Baal, which belongs to your father. Cut down the Asherah that is beside it. Build an altar there to Yahweh your God on the top of this stronghold in an orderly manner. And take a second bull and offer a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah, which you have cut down. And Gideon took 10 men of his servants, did as Yahweh had spoken to him, and because he was too afraid of his father's household and the men of the city to do it by day, he did it by night. Now we're going to unpack these verses. We'll go on a little bit farther in a minute, but let's pause with these right here and look at what it is that Gideon did. A little bit of background. Okay, these are two of the idols that are mentioned here. Baal, who was supposedly controlled the weather, and Asherah was his female god counterpart, kind of his consort, and she was represented by a wooden pole. And this pole, I think of like a totem pole type of thing. But this symbol, okay, it was made out of wood, and then the altar of Baal. Now, the altar of Baal, I don't know what Baal's statue looked like, but this would have been an altar like many other altars, but it was something that was offensive to the Lord. And God told Gideon, I want you to metaphorically take up the sledgehammer. He says, go bring a bull, you know, and so he was probably going to use the animal's power to help pull down this altar because these things were large and made of large stones. And after lifting all that brick yesterday, I can't imagine doing large stones. It would be quite the undertaking. So he goes and he does this. Now, I want you to look at four kind of pieces of this puzzle here. One is that God told him, go up. Go up. There is something that is offensive to me, Gideon. There is something that is in this territory that is an affront to me, and I need you to go up and confront this. Now, I say go up because of the fact that this was, the translation here seems to indicate this was a stronghold. Probably maybe those are often on a hilltop. Okay, this would be a very visible place, and that's often where worship would happen, was on hilltops, you know, getting closer to God or the gods. And so this was probably built up high. And God says, go up and confront this. I want you to go to where the sinful action is taking place, and I want you to confront it. Sometimes God calls us to do the same thing, to go to where the sin is happening, and not just decry it from a distance. I want you to go and I want you to confront. Go up. Have some courage, Gideon. Go up and confront. But I want you to go up and not just confront, I want you to tear down. I want you to remove this thing. Now, when God had commanded the Israelites to go into the promised land, he told them, go in, drive out the inhabitants that are there, and I want you to take and tear down their Asherah poles, tear down the altars. I want you to smash their graven images, their idols. I want you to burn them with fire, completely annihilate idolatry from the land. The images, the equipment, the places, and the people. Idolatry has no place in God's kingdom. And that has not changed in the thousands of years since then. Idolatry still has no place in our lives as well and in our land. Now, what we need to do, though, is when we look at this, we need to confront the idolatry that is right here with us. If you notice, where was this idol? This was referred to as it was his father's altar. This was on Gideon's family property. Now, we'll see later on that this was recognized by others, but it was on the family farm. You know, the family ranch, whatever this was, their property is where this was. So it was his father's. Now, whether his father had commissioned it or his father had just permitted it, it was in his sphere of influence. Within the realm of Gideon's family's authority was where the idolatry was taking place. And God was telling him, Gideon, before you go and deliver Israel from the Midianites, you got to clean house. You got to take care of this. Because remember, why had the Midianite army come in? Why were the foreigners invading? Because of the idolatry of God's people. So before you go and you take care of the foreign army that's coming in, take care of the reason that they have come in. When you guys go to the doctor, sometimes you go because of the fact that, you know, I've got a cough. I've got an ache or a pain. And the doctor will come and they can do a couple of things. They can address the symptom and say, well, here's some pain medicine. Or they can say, let's look inside and let's see what's causing the pain. You understand the difference? I can give you some Tylenol and it might make you feel better for 6 or 8 hours or 4 hours, okay, until that Tylenol wears off. But if you haven't addressed the problem on the inside, you know, the strained muscle or the tumor or whatever it is that's growing inside of you, unless you address the root problem, that pain's just going to keep coming back. You can drive out the Midian army, but until you drive out the idolatry, it's not going to make a difference. We experience some pain in our lives. Sometimes that pain is because of sin. And because if that's the case, then we need to not just cry out to God on because of our pain. We need to cry out to God in repentance and get rid of the idolatry, get rid of the sin that is in our life. And that's exactly what God called Gideon to do. Get rid of this out of your household, out of your family. I want you to stand up and do this. Now, really, Joash, which is Gideon's dad, should have been the one doing this. But God called Gideon. Your dad's not doing it. You do it. You take care of it. Get rid of the sin. Now, a good example of this from our own lives. If we take and we look at our own lives in the mirror and we say, okay, where is there sin in my life? Sometimes we don't want to admit the sin that's there. We don't want to be rid of it. We like to hide it, keep it stashed away. But when God gets a hold of us and we repent and we surrender our lives to Him, God says, okay, you've surrendered yourself to me. Now I want you to go up and I need you to confront this and I need you to get rid of it. I'm going to tell you a story about a guy named Louis Zamperini. Now, you guys may recognize this name. There's a book written called Unbroken. There was a movie made of it, which apparently did not live up to the book at all. The book is fantastic. It's really rough, about a B-24 airman in a B-24 bomber during World War II. He was actually an Olympic athlete as well. And Louis crashed in the Pacific Ocean, was adrift for 70-some-odd days there, you know, battling sharks, hunger, thirst, Japanese fighters that were coming and strafing their raft. Eventually, they get to land, but it's Japanese territory. And so they are he's taken into a prisoner of war camp. They did experiments on him. I mean, he really went through the ringer. And after he survived the war, sorry, I spoiled the book for you. He survives the war. He comes back to the United States, and he suffers from what we would now call PTSD. Post-traumatic stress disorder. They didn't have that title for it back then, but he was really struggling with nightmares. He had been particularly harassed and beaten by a particular Japanese soldier whom the POWs just called the Bird. I don't remember why it was they called him that, but that's what they call him, just the Bird. And so this guy would torment Louis Zamperini there in that Japanese territory, but eventually, even after he came back, he was still tormented by the Bird in his dreams. Now, as you get towards the end of the book, Louis goes at the insistence of his wife to a Billy Graham crusade. Is not at all interested in this, but God takes a hold of his life. And when he does, he understands, Louis understands, there's some house cleaning that needs to happen. And I want to read you this little excerpt from the end of one of these chapters. After he has given his heart to the Lord, it says, when they entered the apartment, Louis went straight to his cache of liquor. It was the time of night when the need usually took hold of him, but for the first time in years, Louis had no desire to drink. He carried the bottles to the kitchen sink, opened them, and poured their contents into the drain. Then he hurried through the apartment, gathering packs of cigarettes, a secret stash of girly magazines, everything that was a part of his ruined years, and he heaved it all down the trash chute. And in the morning, he woke feeling cleansed. For the first time in 5 years, the Bird hadn't come into his dreams. The Bird would never come again. And it goes on to talk about some of the other changes that God brought about in his life. When God saved his soul, Louis understood it's time to clean house. And exactly the same way happens with us. When God takes a hold of our heart, sometimes that means we need to clean house. Now, for us, it might be opening a cabinet and getting rid of, you know, some liquor or pulling some music, you know, off the some CDs out and getting rid of those, or some magazines or some other material. It may mean deleting a social media account. Any other things that we say, you know what, this has no place in the life of a believer. Now, sometimes this is going to be like a little bit of a dusting. You know, I'm just going to clean off a surface here. Other times, this is going to be a lot more painful and a lot more destructive, like taking a sledgehammer to something that has been sacred for a very long time. But if God has taken hold of our hearts, it is time to go through and to clean house. But those are only the first two commands that Gideon is given here. Go up, tear down, and then God tells him, I also want you to do something else, and I want you to build up. I want you to build up the altar of the Lord. Because there were certain commands that God had given about how altars were to be built. They were not to be made from dressed stone. They were just made from natural materials, just from earth, stone, you know, no sort of tools used to fashion it. Build up an altar to the Lord, and then I want you to do something else. I want you to offer up. I want you to offer up a right sacrifice. Now he takes his father's bull, the one 7 years old, which probably means this was prime breeding stock. I mean, they're not going to keep a bull around for that long if it's not going to be useful for building up the herd. So take this, your father's bull, and I want you to offer that up as a sacrifice to the Lord. Remember last week we talked about how important worship was. When God takes hold of our hearts, that we need to, it always needs to lead us to worship. And here, the destruction of one thing led to worship. It led to a worship of the Lord. But the altar to the Lord could not be built until the altar of Baal had been torn down. Because there was a prime piece of real estate in Gideon's community and in Gideon's household land, and that's where that altar was. And God says, I want that prime piece of real estate for me. In our lives, sometimes there is a prime piece of real estate. We say, oh God, I really don't want to surrender this. I really like this part of my life to be under my control instead of under God's control. But God says no. When it comes to the purity of what you put in your body, what you observe with your eyes, what you do with your time, who you spend your time with, where you spend your time with, and what you're doing with them, God says, all of it is mine. I want every single piece of property. So Gideon had to go through, had to clean his family's house. So let me ask you this question before we move on. As you take a look around your property, what do you see? Do you see any strongholds? Any place where there's a vestige of the old life? A vestige of the idolatry that there used to be in your life? Is there any of that left? If there is, got to get rid of it. Got to clean it out. God says, you know, whether you have to take a sponge or a sledgehammer, I want that cleansed. I want all of you. He doesn't want just part of you. He wants all of you. So if there's any spot that needs to be cleansed, put your finger on it, write it down, say, God, I'm surrendering this to you. And when you get home, take whatever piece of equipment you need to remove the old so that you can build the new and offer up to God the worship that he is due. Now, the people who were in Gideon's community didn't necessarily take so kindly to Gideon's actions. Let's keep reading on here. Okay, verse 28. When the men of the city arose early in the morning, behold, the altar of Baal was torn down, and the Asherah which was beside it was cut down. And the second bull was offered on the altar which had been built. And they said to one another, who did this thing? And when they searched about and inquired, they said, Gideon the son of Joash did this thing. Then the men of the city came to Joash, bring out your son that he may die. For he has torn down the altar of Baal, and indeed he has cut down the Asherah which was beside it. But Joash said to all who stood against him, will you contend for Baal, or will you deliver him? Whoever will plead for him shall surely be put to death by morning. If he's a god, let him contend for himself, because someone has torn down his altar. Now verse 32 is really key. Therefore on that day he named him Jerubbaal, that is to say, let Baal contend against him, because he had torn down his altar. The men of the city saw that the skyline had changed overnight. You look up there and, you know, against the sky, against the clouds, there's no longer this altar to Baal. There's a different altar that's there. And they were angry. So apparently this worship that was happening on Joash's property was actually something the community was participating in, and they were extremely angry about it. Now Joash came to his defense, and we don't really see even Gideon saying anything in these, but we do see him receiving a new name. Let God, or let Baal contend with him. That's what that name means, Jerubbaal. You know what? Let Baal contend with him. Now, people sometimes are given nicknames for different reasons. We talked about some of the nicknames I've had in the past, and I know some of you have shared about nicknames that you may have had. Here, he's given a nickname. Now, whether this nickname is kind of a way of deriding him, of putting him down, because it says he said, I don't know if this was his father named him that or somebody else named him that, but he got this nickname that says, let Baal contend with him. Wow. If you were to have that name, every time somebody says that name, they're going to realize every day that Gideon's alive is showing that Baal isn't powerful. My goodness. He went out with courage. He stepped forward. He did something bold. Some people might even say reckless, and he didn't die for it. That's showing that Baal's not as powerful as we might have thought that he was. Every day that he lived showed the enemy was not that powerful. I want my life to be that way. I want for my life to be one that is showing the power of God and showing that Satan is not as powerful as God. But would he have had that reputation had he not gone up? Had he not contended with Baal by tearing down his altar and replacing it with the altar of the Lord? Stepping forward in the midst of a hostile context and saying, I stand for the Lord here. I'm standing for what is right and just. His name became associated with righteousness, with justice, and with the power of God. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about a book that I'm reading right now. It's called Undaunted, and it's by a lady named Christine Kane. We've got a little excerpt here from their website that will be up on the screens. I'm sorry, Jerry, I may have gotten things out of order, but you can go ahead and jump ahead to that. Christine Kane and her husband, Nick, are ones who have started a ministry called A21. And I was trying to figure out, what does the A21 mean? It means the abolishing of all slavery in the 21st century. Did you know that slavery still happens today? We think of it as the people from Africa being enslaved and working the plantations here in the West, but slavery still happens. Around the world, people are taken, and especially a focus of their ministry is rescuing girls who have been brought into the human trafficking realm, that have been kidnapped or lured in and are put into human trafficking. And so Christine, 5'3", little Australian lady, blonde hair, you know, very petite, fireball of energy, as she goes around the world telling people, this is still happening and we're not going to let it happen. Are you going to join me in doing something about it? She is one who is confronting an altar to the enemy. As people are brought for profit, for sensuality, and they are taken and forced into this lifestyle, and she's saying, no, these people do not have a voice, but I'm going to be a voice for them. And so when you think of, you know, this problem of slavery or human trafficking, Christine's name is one of them that comes up in the media. It comes up, I think, even in secular media, not just Christian media, because of the fact she's doing something about it. She and Nick are standing against this, traveling around the world, telling people this is real, it's got to change, and they're getting right in there, and they are rescuing and helping to rehabilitate these people whose lives have been shattered. So when we think of her name, we automatically think of somebody who is standing against something of the enemy, just the same way that Gideon stood against something of the enemy. Now, as we try to circle this back down for ourselves and think of, okay, that's great. I mean, I can maybe join Christine in what she's doing, but I don't know if that's what I'm called to do. That's the key. How did Gideon know that he was to go up and tear down the altar of Baal? Because God told him to. How did Christine know that she was supposed to? God laid it on her heart very clearly. I'd encourage you to read her book. But what for each of us? You might not be called to go confront an altar of Baal or to go and confront human trafficking, but are there idols in our community? Are there places that you would look at and say, that's taking advantage of people? This is keeping them beaten down. This is keeping them wrapped up in addiction. I think God wants me to do something about that. God came to Gideon and said, go up and do it. We need to have a heart that is sensitive and seeking God so that when he tells us, this is something I want you to confront, that we are willing to go up, we're willing to tear it down, we're willing to say, this is an established place for the worship of God here, and I'm going to offer up worship and I'm going to call other people to do the same along with me. That's what we need to do. So, as we look at our own lives, be ready for the fact that God may call you to go up and to do that. But also, God may first say, before you go do something grand, I need you to clean house personally. So this is what I want to challenge you with. Not only listen for the bigger call, but listen, Lord, where is there an idol still in my home? Where is there an idol in my life? Where is there a territory that is still dedicated to the enemy that I can be rid of, that I need to be rid of in order to honor you? So as we sing this closing song, I would encourage you, examine your heart, say, God, speak to me. Show me, is there territory for the enemy? Is there a place of worship that is dedicated to the enemy that I need to do something about in my own life or elsewhere. So I want to tell you one other verse that I skipped over. And Jerry, I'm going to go to those Corinthian verses here. You can go ahead and do that. I skipped over those as I was going through. And 1 Corinthians chapter 10, it talks about what an idol is. And it says, what do I mean then? This is verse 19. 1 Corinthians 10, 19. What do I mean then? That a thing sacrificed to idols is anything? Or that an idol in it is anything? No, but I say that the things with the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. I do not want you to become sharers in demons. We often in the West look at people who worship idols as like, oh, that's just ridiculous. How could they think that that's a god? But what Paul is pointing out, there's a demon behind that statue, that image that people are worshiping. And just because there may not be an image that we are worshiping, an idol, a physical, tangible thing, does not mean that we are not offering worship to demons. Anything that pulls worship away from God is an idol. So whether it is something in your wallet, something on your screen, something in your home, or a person in your life, anything can become an idol if it takes the place that rightly belongs to God. So as we sing this final song, God, say, God, is there anything that has your rightful place? And I want to be rid of it so I can worship you. Trust and that obedience is sometimes easy, sometimes it's hard, but it always ends well in the long run if we choose to do things God's way. So may you go forth making it a great week in the Lord, seeking Him, cleansing what He needs, what He calls you to cleanse, demolishing what He calls you to demolish, but then building up that right worship of Him where He calls you to do so as well. Love you guys. See you again soon.